Imagine creating beautiful boxes just like these. Well, you can, and it's much easier than you think. Gifkins Dovetail manufactures the easiest jig on the market. It's the only Australian-made dovetail jig. It's so simple to use and cuts precise joints every time. There's no measuring, no fiddling, and no fuss. We even offer box making courses to suit all levels. And of course, every purchase comes with our after-sales service. So explore our website to see the Gifkins jig and so much more.
Do your thing.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to 2021. Who would have thought it, eh? Okay. I hope everybody's well and happy. I hope you've all had a good start to the year. We had a nice quiet one.
No, we didn't. But we worked our clackers off.
We've got a couple of new things happening in the show this year. First of all, I would like you to meet E.T. This little guy here, we've decided to sort of try a different way of showing you how to get a better visual of some of the little intricate things that we do around boxes. So we're going to give this a bit of a go. The other thing you might have just heard a moment ago was the producer and the director is now mic'd up. Okay, so if you ask a question and she answers, she'll answer verbally so that I can talk to you. So you may hear her in the background. Let us know how you feel about that or how you see how that works. If it's disturbing to you, well, let me know. If it's something that works for you, okay, let me know about that too. So we'll give it a shot and we'll see how we go. So let's get started. All right, now remember this. For those of you who were watching at the end of last year, this is what we did, okay? We drew up the plan for an uneven-sided box. We cut the framework and got it all ready for the next task. And this is what we came up with, the uneven-sided box. So what we want to do with this one here, over the next couple of weeks, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a number of different types of lids and some internal bits and pieces for this particular box. Now, the box will all be the same. What I'm going to do is I'm going to change the lids and show you how to come up with some different ideas of what to do with boxes and how to sort of make them sort of lift a little bit. So we'll see how that goes, and we'll start off with a very simple one, and then we'll go through and do some a little bit more elaborate ones, and I'll give you some ideas on what to do with some of the boxes so that you can make up your own mind, fit it to your style of box making, and also to just help you along a little bit for some of the skills that you might want to lift in your box making. So we'll go through each of those, and hopefully ET will help you as well. We can get a little bit closer to everything, see what's going on, and get some ideas. So let's get started. This is the box that I showed you. I think it was two shows ago. This is the one that I put together for you so that I could give it a little bit of a demonstration on it. The top of that is a nice piece of bird's eye silver ash. Now, the bird's eye silver ash sort of matches up to the silver ash on the sides of the box, and all my internal componentry will end up being silver ash as well. That just lightens the inside of the box. So I'm going to make a top. I won't make it out of silver ash. This is the board that I cut that from. And the unfortunate thing about this is it's not quarter sawn. Now, I talked about this when we did the preparation for the timber, about quarter sawn timber. And if it's not quarter sawn, you'll end up with issues where the humidity will change regularly on your in your room, in the house, wherever you keep the box, and you'll end up with the top actually moving. I've had this sitting inside our house, and over the last 4 days, I've had it 2 millimeter gap appearing underneath the box here, underneath the lid. And as you can see now, it's quite flat. So if I go to ET, and you'll see that it's quite flat. And that's just because the temperature changed, the humidity changed, the box is fine. It's not always a good idea to have that happening to the box all the time. So your best bet is to go for quarter sawn as best you can to get the good result. Now, what I'm going to do here is I've got some rose mahogany, a nice piece, and this is quarter sawn. So I'm going to use that to make the lid for my second box, okay? So we'll go through that process. Now, to get that to work, what I need to do is prep the box first. If you look at the box, you'll see that the lid fits neatly. I'll go to here. The lid fits nice and neatly into the two ends of the box. And when you open the box, you'll also see, if you can see that, let's see if I can get it so that you can see it. There is a step along this edge here. Okay, so I've got a little step there. If I could put it this way. It's not enough light, unfortunately. There, you can see that step there. Okay, so I've got that step across there. So I'm going to have to put a recess in there. The other thing you can see also is I've got the end of it rounded over so that it flows off the edge of the box. Okay, so we'll do all those sorts of things. But first, before we do that, what I need to do is I need to make sure that the two ends are parallel with each other and parallel with the base. We then need to make sure that the front and the back are parallel to all of those as well. Okay, so there's a few techniques we need to do to get it to do that, to get it to be like that, so that when we put the whole thing together, it's nice and flat. Okay, so let's get that out of the way. And this is what we're going to do. Your first task is to make sure that the base is flat so that your feet are all nice and even. So you need to have those flat. If you can hear that, there's a little bit of a rock in there. So I need to sand the bottom of my feet a little bit. Don't take too much off because you don't have a lot of material to play with. So just a small amount to be taken off. So to do that, my trusty sanding board.
I like this technique. It's just so simple and quick.
Did you hear Pammy then? She likes it. Okay, so what I've got is my flat surface. So all I'm going to do now, I can get off this, just go to me. All I'm going to do now is just very carefully, I'm not taking a lot, not pressing hard, just giving it a light sand, turn it around. Remember I said to you real early in the piece, we are creatures of habit and we need to make sure that we're even all the way around. And there you go. So that didn't take long at all, just a very light sand. So I want those flat. Back where it come from. Incidentally, that sandpaper was only 400, so it's not a really coarse sandpaper, just enough to take that off and get it flat. Okay, my next task now is to make this piece parallel to that piece. To do that, I need a fence. And the router bit that I'm going to use, Derek, this is another task for the TSRW12 if you're watching. This is what it looks like. Let me go to here. The TSRW12. This is the one that I use to make the feet. Now, all I need to do now is run that through here. So all I need to do is adjust the height. And as you can see, I'm just a little bit above. Hang on, I have to shift DT for you. How's that? I'm just a little bit above the material. So all I'm going to do now is run that through. But first of all, I have to adjust it. Need a clamp. Now, when you adjust it, one of the things that happens occasionally is humidity will change things as you're cutting, right? So the height from the bench to there, and the bench to here, and the bench to here, that could be different. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use all four corners to adjust my router bit. Okay, so the depth of cut from there. So, and I'm only doing this by eye. There's no need to be real fussy about it. It only just touches the corner. Try the other corner. About the same. And then I'll do it from this side. So I'll just do it from this side. And as you can see, that one touches, so I'll just bring it in a tiny little bit. Okay, so I'm actually looking for the shortest distance from the bottom of the foot to the top. And once I've got that done, lock that in place. We're all locked in. Now all I need to do is run straight through. Okay? I think I might have moved that. I did. That's too short. Just got to bring that back a tiny bit. There we go. So all I'm going to do now is run straight through. The thing to be careful with this is, though, you have a router bit sticking up and you're going to be pushing from the back. You do not want to have your fingers anywhere near that router bit. So get into a habit. I generally hold my fingers on top there, and I use this one here and stay well above the router bit and out of the way. Okay, so you need to be very, very careful. Now, the thing that I'm doing here, I'm going to just go to my top camera for a sec. What's going to happen here is that router bit spins in this direction. So it goes in that direction. So what I want is the router bit to actually push the material to the fence. If you come back the other way, it's cutting on its offset. So you need to have it pushing onto the piece of timber in its cutting phase. Okay, so let's go back here, and I'm just going to feed that through there. So ears on, everybody. So now what we have, a perfectly smooth, clean surface, and that is parallel to that. Okay, so we've got them both parallel. Now what I need to do is I need to cut my rebate in the two shoulders.
Col, Steel Wood asks, can you explain the direction you're going to be going in and why? Were you doing a particular direction, or it was just the way that you had the box positioned?
That's what I did with the top camera. To say this again, the rotating router bit spins in this direction.
Is that clockwise?
Anti-clockwise.
Right.
What it does in its cutting process, it's pushing your piece of timber against the fence. If you have it going the other way, it will kick it away from the fence and you'll end up with a big gouge in the top. That's why I'm going in that direction. Is that clear?
Yeah, I think so.
Somebody get that?
Yeah. Yeah, so really it's just revisiting each time why you're doing particular things. It takes people a little while to get it, because to you it's instinctive.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, next step, cut my rebates. Now, when I cut my rebates, I'm going to use our tenon cutter. A tenon cutter, the beauty about this tenon cutter is that the angle of the tooth on there is 8 degrees. That 8 degrees will give you a very nice clean shearing cut. So it's really good for this task. So I'll just swap that over. The depth of your trench, the depth of your trench depends on how your design is and what you want to do with your design. So to set the height, just got to shift some stuff here. To set some height, I'm doing this again. So what I want to do is I want to make sure that the distance from the bottom, I'll find a pencil to show you then. The distance from the bottom to the top edge of that, of your thing there, has to be the same as the other end. Okay, so up here. That has to be the same on this side as well. So when I set the height of my router bit, I'm setting it so that it touches the top edge there. Now I have to go around all four corners to see that working. I get a little bit off there, a little bit off there, a little bit off there. And I think that one is, that's a little bit off there. If you want to be really prescriptive, what you can do is you can measure the height of that to 10 millimetres and you can cut it down to 10 mil. Okay, that will give you an exact measurement. I generally don't do that. Generally all I do is just make sure that surface and this surface are both exactly the same. So that's going to cut there. Now, setting your fence. Bring the fence in. And you can see that I don't have a lot of distance between the tip of the router bit and the fence. If I slide my box up to there, you see, I can move it away a little bit. Just get it parallel. So I'm cutting out about a millimeter and a half, maybe 2 mil. Just lock that. so. I'll just move ET a little closer so that you can see if that give you an idea. We have a lighting problem. I think we're going to have to do something about our light. That's probably giving you a little bit more light, but you can see I've come in just a tiny little bit, right? Now all I'm going to do is feed that along here. Just bring UT back a tiny bit so that we can. So all I'm going to do now is I'm going to feed that through same way. The router bit spins in an anti-clockwise direction. It's pushing your timber against the fence, and that's what you want it to do. If you have it coming the other way, it'll have a tendency to push it away from the fence, and that will cause you some injury to your timber. Okay, folks, ears on. Now, you won't see all the cutting happening on this one, but you'll see the finished result at the end. Just had to do a little check. Notice when I cut through there, I had my thumb on the top, resting on the top of that, and I had my fingers on the outside of the fence, like so, and I just slid that straight through like that with pressure on there. And this one, this hand on the other end, with just a guide. Okay? And when you look at that, I've got a nice little 1 millimeter step on the inside of the box. It's really hard to see. Oh, you can see it better there. I've also taken off a little piece of material here and here. Okay? So if I flip that over and do the other side exactly the same. You can see I've got a little step there, okay, so that's my little step, and I also got a little step here and here, okay. All I need to do now is just dress that across there and across here, okay. So, all I have to do is sit that, and I'll shift ET again for you. All I'm going to do here is I'm going to slide in and just slide along, okay? So now I have my little step at both ends. I have a flat surface there and a flat surface there. And all of those surfaces, if your table's flat, will be parallel to each other. And they will be also parallel to the base. Okay, so your box is in perfect condition. if there's any variation in what the joints look like, it's so minimal that you can't see it anyway. Okay, so that's how we get it to there. The next step is to round over both my ends. So do that. Now the rounding over bit that I'm going to use here is the same one that I used on my trinket box, the desktop box. Which is that one there. So the important thing to remember when you're cutting this next bit is to make sure that the corner edge of the router bit is right on the corner edge of your box. So clean off any residual that might be there. We'll drop this down. I'm only rounding over too, so that's all I'm doing. Locked in place. And then all I'm going to do now, got to be careful. See how we've got an overlap there? It won't be flat if you use it this way. So I'm just going to use it that way. Okay, so the whole box is sitting flat on the table. So ears on. Now when we start in the center of the router bit and we finish in the center of the router bit. So it's in, along, back out. Okay. Lovely little round over on the corner. Now, here's the fun bit. It's going to take a little bit of explanation, this one. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk to you about hinges, because my next task is to actually cut the trenches and the rebates for the hinges. Now, a purist we'll get a marking gauge and a square, and they'll square it up, and then they'll use U-butte chisel to cut the rebates for the hinges. And what I'm doing is simplifying it so that it makes it a little easier for those of you who may be a little bit shaky with your tools, or you're finding it difficult to operate the tools. So what I'm going to do is do it very simply on the router. But you've got to get the right place. Now, hinges. The hinges are a bone of contention amongst lots of people. Everybody's got a different idea of what a hinge does, how it goes, what it's supposed to do, what it's supposed to look like. But the overarching question I get all the time is, how can you make this simple? How can you do it quickly? Because people will not sit and take the time to fit them. You've got to get the hinge that suits the job you're doing. That's the first task. The second one, there's no simple, easy way of doing things that doesn't take some sort of effort. It's time and patience to fit them, and you need to take that time. There are simple ways of fitting hinges and things like that, but they're not generally easy. So work as simply as you can and get the hinges that suit the job you're doing. Now, there are a couple of sellers in town who you can go along to Bunnings and you can buy some fairly cheap hinges, but they generally don't have the size for box makers. Jim Carroll down in Victoria carries a fairly wide range of Chinese made hinges that are adequate for simple beginner boxes. And this is what they look like. These ones that I'm showing you now are generally butt hinges, straight out butt hinges. You can see these ones here are 1 inch, the bigger ones. You can see I've got them in two different colours. I've got chrome ones and you've got brass ones. Okay, so they're standard butt hinges. If you're using butt hinges, you'll find that you need to have some sort of stay to stop the lid from flopping open. Okay, so you'll need a corner stay of some description. And you can get lots of those or little bits of chain and so on. I tend to use fishing line. You can buy black-coated fishing line with little clips, and you can use that. And then they're not very well seen. You know, you can't see them very well. So you can use that to do some boxes. But these are the sort that Jim Carroll will have in his stock. So you can get them off him. So there's a link for him. I think he's actually on there. If you're there, Jim. There's a link to his website where you can order these and get them. If you want to go upmarket a little bit, there's Anton Gurner hinges. Anton's in Melbourne, and he has these probably a little bit better quality than those Chinese ones. They're these ones here are a nice, good, solid butt hinges. Again, same thing. You need some sort of stay to stop them from flopping open, but they are very, very good quality. Also, there's a link to Anton on their, if you look down on the
on the bottom of the info, the description on YouTube on this page, and also resources for box makers on the front of our website. There's details for Anton Gurner and also for Carol's Woodwork Supplies.
Okay, so that's they're good quality. These ones here are a little cheaper than these ones here. As you can see, these ones here are very, very high quality. So they're good ones. So if you just want to get some simple boxes made with some simple hinges, that can be a good idea. Now, what I'm going to use on this box here are these little hinges here. These are what we call stop hinges. Now, they open out to, or they're supposed to open out to 91 degrees. Jim has these as well. These are the Chinese ones. They're a reasonable sort of a quality, but unfortunately, some of them need a little bit of work to actually get them to work properly. So you'll need to have a sort of, at least a sort of basic knowledge of how a hinge works properly and what it should do to work well. If you want to go upmarket with these hinges, then you can go to these ones here. These are Brusso hinges, and they're imported from the US, and they are extremely good quality. They're up there with the Gurner hinges that I showed you earlier. They're good quality like that, and quite a lot of people import them. Now, there's lots of other different types of hinges. There's quadrant hinges, there's side rail hinges, and so forth. I'm not going to go into those details at the moment because it's really not necessary for this box. But you can see with the Brusso hinges, the sizes are a little bit different. They don't have a 1-inch one or a 25 millimeter one. They have this one here, which is 3/4, and this one here is 1 1/4 inch. Being US, of course, they've got to be different to everybody. One of the things that you'll notice with stop hinges is they're generally square on the back. You have a look at a butt hinge, and the butt hinge is round on the back. Okay, so you're going to get a different visual effect on the back of the box anyway. Now, that needs extra work to actually get it to work properly, so I'm going to show you how to do that. But 1-inch hinges are what we're going to use, so I'll put all these away. Now, I could go on for another hour and a half or 2 hours about hinges, but I don't think you want to hear that. No. So what we're going to do is we're going to cut the rebates for the butt hinges. Now, Carbitool also makes some really good quality heavy duty straight bits. Now, this one here is a 1-inch one. Don't get it confused with the 25 millimeter one. Those people who think that 1 inch is equal to 25 millimeters, not right. You won't get it right. So 1 inch, these are 1 inch. If you've got 25 millimeter hinges, then of course I'd use that router bit. Okay, now that's exactly the same size as my hinge. Okay, so I'm going to use that to cut my rebate. It's a big router bit. It vibrates a little bit, but once it gets going, it's good. Now, the depth of my cut has to be the depth of my hinge. Okay, so that's 2 millimeters. So what I need to do is I need to find a spot on the back edge where I'm going to put the hinges. So work out where you want your hinges. So if I put one here and one there, okay, I'll just bring ET up a little bit so you can see what's going on. So where you want them is up to you, and that's based around your design. Okay, so I have a standard measurement that I do, and that is 40 millimeters from the outside edge to the inside edge of my So I have two marks, one at 40 mil. That's my standard for this size box. You can change it. Upscale, do something else, but that looks quite nice when you've got it like so. Okay, so it's starting to look a little bit like a box with a pair of hinges. So what I need to do is then set my depth down the side, down here. I need to set that at 2 millimeters. So that's 2 millimeters. I could use a scribe to do this, but I don't need to. So you can see there's my 2 millimeter mark. What I'm going to do is I'm going to set the router bit to that height. I'm sitting it on here. Now the question's going, Pammy.
Oh, good. Very good.
Is everybody happy?
Yeah. They're intrigued by what you're doing. I was just going to make the comment that this process will be repeated time and again as you're doing yes. boxes in the future. So these same details will be covered again and again. And even though there's a lot to take in just doing what is seemingly a simple hinge system, mm-hmm. yeah, it'll be material that'll be covered again and again, won't it?
That's correct, yes. So just a matter of setting up a fence now. Now the easy bit about this is all I need to do is measure distance from my router bit to the fence at 40 millimeters. Again, as I've said all the way through this, these exercises, accuracy when you're making a bespoke box can be anything, and you can adjust things as you go along. So you don't need to be really prescriptive unless you've got somewhere for the box to be. Like it might be a drawer where you've got exact measurements to be. If you're a millimetre or half a millimetre or a quarter of a millimetre out, so long as you do the same on the other end of the box, it'll be all good. Okay. Now this little task. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to just pass that over the top, right? Now, the thing about this is because you're going this way, you can't cut through that way. Well, sorry, you can, but you've just got to be careful that you're working on the same side every time. So, and this is a very slow process. So ears on, everybody. Perfectly in there. Okay, so what I'll do now is I will screw that hinge in place. I'm not going to do it at the moment, but we'll do that in the next session. We're sort of running out of time for the tasks that I have to perform today, but that's where our hinges are going to be. And you can see they fit in there really nicely. A little bit of sanding to get all these little furry bits off, but basically I've got my hinges in the perfect spots. Okay, let me take that out of there.
And you're working from the outside in,
yep,
so that you have a nice clean shearing cut.
Yep, and that's how it works. These have got a vertically, these have got a, the router bit is straight up and down, the teeth on it, and they do tend to fur up a little bit. So a little bit of sandpaper, and we'll fix that in a second. Don't grab hold of the little extra bit and peel off. Make sure it comes back into the hole. You know, and then when we sand it off, it'll keep a nice sharp edge on the rebate. So now my next task is to make a panel for the inside. So my panels for the inside are made from just a piece of plywood. So a piece of plywood with bays stuck on it, a little tag to pull it off. So I want to make a little piece of sandpaper. Okay, so a little piece of 240. So when I'm doing, just give it a light sand just to tidy up all those little furry bits. Like so. See that they're really, really nice little rebates now. Yeah.
Col, Aussie man wants to know, have you ever considered making wooden hinges?
Tell him it's Aussie. Wooden hinges are going to be a show in itself down the track. So if you just hang in there, we will be doing wooden hinges. Another task. You're jumping ahead, mate.
The plans are actually on our website under free download. So if you want to experiment with it, there's detailed plans for two different types of wooden hinges. So have a look at that after the show. It's a bit detailed, but yep, doable, certainly.
The other thing, Aussie, is that the hinges that you see on the website are, have been developed by Roger Gifkin in the past, and there are some router bits on it that Roger uses that are not available anymore. So there are some tiny little things there. So what I've done is I've changed the technique of making the hinges to incorporate our F5 finger joint jig. So that's going to be one of the things that we do in future.
Mm, good to know.
So hang in there, buddy. We'll get it there. Okay. Piece of plywood. This is what we're using to do our base, and a piece of self-adhesive base. You can, we're going to cut this to size, so it's going to fit inside there, and then I'm going to stick that onto there. So I'm going to go to the saw in a sec, and I'm going to dress this piece of timber up. I have to take my box with me, and we'll change ET so that he's watching over my shoulder. Just going to see if ET is doing the right thing. Well, that should just about get it there, I think. Okay, I'll go over and set myself up over there, and we'll cut this to size. So you can't see me, but I'm here. So the first thing I'm going to do is dress an edge. Ears on, everybody. And I'm going to dress the other edge. Now I know these are square because my fence. So I have a square edge here and a square edge there. What I need to do now is just measure up my box. So when I measure the box, just measure across here. So I've got 138. So I measure to 138. Pam, can you see the laser light on the screen?
No, not so much.
Fits perfect. Now I need a distance and a length. And when I measure the length, there is a 230.5. ET back.
Oh yes, I did actually. Now that I'm watching the delayed feed, I can see the red laser light.
Okay, so we're back again. Now what I have here is now I have my piece of plywood. So I'm just going to sand up the edges a little bit. Just taking the furry bits off, that's all I need to do. And I have a nice clean piece of plywood. I want the box to fit in that way. Okay, so you can see it's got a little bit of a warp in it, but not too worried about that. It'll be okay once we do the dressing of the inside. Now, our piece of baize, nice piece of self-adhesive red baize. Just like so. Just make sure it's right to the edge of somewhere. This one's right on the corner there, but it'll be okay. And then what I want to do now is cut up the size. Now, the piece of material that I've got here, you can see it's all scratched up and chopped about, and it's in a pretty poor state. Basically, that's because this is what it's used for, and it's just so that I don't chop up my desk, my bench. So, a Stanley knife, and what I'm going to do here, I'm just going to cut the edges off it. Like so. You can, if you want, cut these to fold over, but I've cut the piece of material to fit exactly in the box. And so there I have my piece of base. Now the tag. As you can see, some of these tasks are very simple, very easy, not hard to do. You can buy this stuff at
Spotlight.
So all it is just a little bit of ribbon. Okay, you can see it's shiny on one side, it's not very shiny on the other. And I just cut myself a piece. I want a piece of tape as well, so super glue. Don't overdo the super glue, you don't need a lot, just enough to hold it in place. Take that on there about the middle somewhere. It's not a critical measurement. And I'll tape that down. Now, the last little bit, you'll notice that it's shiny side down when you're doing this, so that it sits shiny side up on the inside. What I'm doing on the back of it is putting a little bit of super glue, and that little bit of super glue will stop the end from fraying. And there's my internal tray. So that will fit inside there. I just got to dry out that super glue. A little piece of this. Just want to dry that super glue off quickly. Otherwise it sticks in the box. You can't get it out at all. And there we have the inside of the box done. How nice is that? Pretty clear, yeah. Pretty clever one. Okay. So there we have it. Our box frame is now ready for a lid. Okay, so that's taken just over 3/4 of an hour. So once you get used to doing the processes, and once you get used to setting up and going through each little activity, you'll find that it'll be quite nice, quite easy. And when you get used to it, you can do a half a dozen at a time. So that's my basis for a lid. Okay, you need to cut that rebate on both sides before you actually measure up for the lid. When we put the lid in there, the lid has to fit snug. It has to be a tight fit. That way you're going to get accuracy when you start putting the hinges in for the lid. Okay, so the first thing we do then is we start and we get our piece of material. What I've done with this material, this stuff, is it's wider than I need, and it's really hard to find a lot of these timbers that are wide enough. You don't need to use material that matches anything else. You could use something that sort of stands out a little bit on the box and makes the box that little bit special because it's got that feature on the top of the box. The other thing is you can do a lot of work on these. You can make all sorts of different types. You can make a plastic lid. You can make carve bits and pieces in lids and do all sorts of different things. What we are going to do is we're going to make a simple lid to start with, and then next week when we get really into the lids, I'm going to do a couple of other little things with lids. We might do a frame and panel lid, we might do an edged lid. So two or three different lids over, hopefully over an hour, we should be able to get most of those sorts of things done. I'll have to do a bit of prep before the start, but we will get that done fairly quickly. So that'll be a whole session in itself, just making lids. What I want to do at the moment is just fit this lid to this box, and then we'll go through the finishing process of the box and make it look pretty, and we'll have another gift to give someone. Okay, now, where's my rule? Here it is. So the length of my piece of material is going to be, I'm going to cut it at 235 millimetres, which is right on the distance between the two tops there. The width of it is 160 millimetres. Okay, so 160 millimetres, and that will give me a little bit of an overlap so that I can actually fiddle around and get the lid to fit perfectly. If you want to make it bigger, by all means make it wider, so that you've got overlap both sides, and that way you've got something to play with on the end. One of the techniques we're going to do next week with making the lid is also we're going to run a rebate along the front edge so that we've got a lifting lip. It's a very simple one, an easy one, if you don't have the techniques to make a proper catch system. Okay, so we'll go over that next week as well. Okay, so all I'm going to do with this one here is I'm going to cut the length, and that should just about do us for the day. So 160.
Col, might just a little bit up in the chat.
Yeah.
Mike Jamison asked, is there anything you can do to prevent the tear out? Use tape maybe?
Yes, you can put some tape over the top of it if you like.
Yeah, of course. Good.
Or you can clamp a piece of timber either side of a...
Yeah, right. Yes, like the sacrificial boards on the jig.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm just going to cut this timber, so I'll bring ET back to have a look. Okay. What measure, can you remember what measurement that was, guys? 235. Okay, so I'm going to dress the end first. 135. Incidentally, you'll notice there's a nice and smooth piece of material. I dressed and sanded the material to 600 grit, just to make things a little bit easier for me later down the track. Then I'm going to dress that back edge. Come on, ET, let's go back. How's ET working for you guys? Is that good? Is it, what do you think?
Aside from getting the wobbles sometimes, I think it's good vision. And I think a couple of our viewers think so too.
Good. You'll notice that does not quite fit. Okay. It's not because it's out of square or anything like that. It's just that I've cut it that quarter of a millimetre more. So I'm going to just dock that for a sec. Just give me a tip.
Yeah, you're getting a good result.
Good feedback on that?
Yeah.
Okay, so what we have there, that fits in there. There is no movement whatsoever in that box lid. And it's very important that you get to that stage, okay? So we're going to call it quits there because the next task means that I've got a little bit of extra stuff to do. And we'll catch up and we'll put the hinges in next week. We'll do stuff to the front edge of it. We'll have a little play with it. And you'll see how simple and easy it is to do that. But take your time dressing up your box. Make sure it's perfect all the way around. And as you can see, I didn't work very hard. All I did was just follow through each of the little tasks correctly. And we come up with a box that's pretty good. Okay. So that's it for today, guys. I hope you enjoyed the show and feedback next week about how you felt with Pammy overlaying a couple of questions and things like that. What you thought of ET, and we'll sort of hopefully get that working. Now, if you like what you saw, don't forget to press that the bell on your subscription button, and we'll give you a reminder as to when we're going. So have a good day, folks. And for those of you who go straight to Dave Stanton, enjoy the day, guys. I don't know what he's doing today.
He's using the B10 template with some book match timbers. So it'll be a fantastic project.
Okay. Yes. Well, there you go. I didn't know that. So
yeah.
Have a good day, guys. And I will see you.